Illinois faces some big challenges. Today, you're about to hear a truly honest analysis of the problems we face. Equally important, you'll also hear an in-depth discussion of some practical solutions. This is your radio source for stories, the insight, and the answers you won't hear anywhere else, not on the media, and not coming from Springfield. You're listening to Illinois Rising, presented by the Illinois Opportunity Project. Now, here's your host, AM 560's Dan Proft.
Welcome to another edition of Illinois Rising. Dan Proft. I am the co-host of Chicago's Morning Answer with Amy Jacobson, 5 to 9 a.m. weekdays on AM 560. And joining me is Pat Hughes, co-founder of the Illinois Opportunity Project. And Pat, it's big news this week, the continued descent into madness, as far as I'm concerned, by Governor Rauner. The report out from one of my publications, Prairie State Wire, that Governor Rauner intends to sign House Bill 40, which is the taxpayer funding of abortion on demand in Illinois. This after he promised both the House and Senate Republican caucuses that he would veto it, and he promised the Illinois electorate when he ran for governor that he would, quote, have no social agenda, unquote. And over the last 4 weeks, we've gotten transgender birth certificates, we've gotten sanctuary state, and now it appears we're getting House Bill 40.
Yeah, it looks like he's trying to carve out a different legacy, Dan, than he originally claimed he intended.
Joining us for more on this topic is a state legislator who met with Governor Rauner this week regarding his commitment on HB 40. He is State Representative Tom Morrison, Republican from Palatine, who joins us now. Tom, thanks for joining us. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Dan. Thanks, Pat.
So you met with the governor again on this topic of House Bill 40 and taxpayer-funded abortion on demand. And can you give us a sense of how that meeting went and what you take away from it?
I think we reiterated a lot of the points that we had brought up in the spring. And obviously there's been a little bit of a change in the dynamic with J.B. Pritzker entering the race and just really in a full-throated way trying to push this issue, trying to push him. But, I mean, it's clearly a trap that the governor would fall into if he were to sign it as is.
Well, and partly, I mean, even dispensing with the morality of the issue for a moment. So it's an integrity test because he previously committed to veto it, and he previously committed to the Illinois population that he would not have no social agenda. This would make Illinois the most radical state in the nation when it comes to taxpayer funding of abortion. That's just a fact, because this will be the first state that is legislative and gubernatorial initiated taxpayer funding of abortion on demand. So it's an integrity test in part. The other thing, it's a political competency test, because a supermajority of likely Illinois general election voters oppose it.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, I mean,
well, you know, what's the rationale, I guess, as I'm searching for, if he's worried about J.B. Pritzker and being pilloried by Pritzker over the topic, if he's just playing politics with it, this doesn't sound like sound politics.
I mean, those were points that we have brought up to him, to his some of his key staff, and we're hoping that he'll do the right thing. I mean, there are a number of ways for him to. Well, first of all, we were very grateful when he said in the spring that he would veto it, and some of the public comments he made were that this is a very controversial issue. Well, yeah, it is. I mean, we all have, the culture is divided on this issue, although it's clear to see that over the last years and decades, the culture is shifting more to an understanding of the right to life. I mean, you can't deny the science of it. You can't deny the ultrasound images. More and more women and men who were involved in an abortion decision in the past are recognizing that it was a mistake and are courageously saying so. And so the culture is shifting on this, but even so, there are still some that think that abortion is a necessary evil. And so I talk to those people, and I say, okay, I get that you think that an individual should make that decision for their own, but do you think that all of society should have to participate in that via tax dollars? And again, people say, no, I can't go there. I don't believe that. And that's why the Hyde Amendment has been maintained through Republican and Democrat administrations on a national level. It's why it was state policy for as long as it has been. this would be a tragedy on so many levels if HB 40 were to be signed. And so I think there are other ways to deal with this, and we're hoping that he'll do the right thing.
Yeah, plus, Tom, and you know, this can't be overemphasized, for those folks who are either you know, not in the camp of being pro-life or aren't in the camp of saying, well, I don't care if we're forcing people to do something against their faith or emotional will by taxpayer funding, we don't have the money, right? So even if you were on the side of all these other things, we don't have enough money to pay for the bills we have already, and now we're going to add this additional benefit through the Medicaid system or through this state employee worker system. Can't we even appeal to him on that fact after he's run as a fiscal reformer all this time?
Well, I mean, and this is the really disgusting aspect of it, that there are some proponents of this issue that really believe that abortion is more cost advantageous than supporting individuals on public assistance.
Because it eliminates people that you won't have to support down the road, according to them.
Poor people, that's right. And what I brought up in my, I mean,
unbelievable.
It's just so offensive. It is so offensive on so many levels that I don't know where to start. But I do hear that argument from time to time, and I think that they really believe that.
And there's more than a little tinge of racism to that remark as well.
Well, absolutely. I mean, you look at where abortion clinics are located, and again, you look at the entire history of the modern abortion movement. You go back 100 years from the founding of Planned Parenthood or the organization that preceded Planned Parenthood, and essentially the theme is more children from the fit, less from the unfit. That's what makes this so wrong. I brought up during the debate on HB 40, you know, Steve Jobs was conceived by a couple of college students up at the University of Wisconsin, and his birth mother courageously gave him up for adoption. The iPhone I'm talking on right now would not exist had Steve Jobs' birth mother not given him life.
Right.
And later, Steve Jobs went back to thank her, and he said, "I thanked her for not aborting me."
Yeah,
I thanked her for not aborting me.
Well, I mean, the stories of that, people come from humble and difficult beginnings to go on to change the world, are legion. I mean, Beethoven.
Absolutely.
Beethoven, for starters.
Dan Proft.
Well, yes, I don't belong in that category, but yes, I mean, I'm the beneficiary of adoption as well, and I was born 9 months before Roe v. Wade. So, yeah, and do you think that's relevant to me? Sure it is.
Let's give women real choices, real choices. I just read an interesting book, Democrats for Life, written by Kristen Day, based out of Washington, D.C., and she said, we're not giving women the real choice. So one argument I read in Crane's, you know, supporting HB 40, was, you know, women who face an unplanned pregnancy, you know, based on the money, they're not going to be able based on the cost of an abortion, they are not going to be able to, continue with a career or whatever, have a stable household. So we're basically saying, we'll pay for your abortion, but we're not going to help you in that unplanned pregnancy. We're not going to give you a real choice. And that was one of the themes in Kristen Day's book. We need to give women a real choice.
Absolutely.
And so many of us in the pro-life movement, that's where we're putting our time and energy and resources, to give women that real choice. Not just, we're just going to give you an abortion and leave you to deal with the consequences emotionally and physically. It is an appalling choice that we're forcing upon people.
Well, if Governor Rauner makes the appalling choice that I've reported he's going to make from people very close to the situation, then what is the Republican response going to be? What are you going to do? What do you think your colleagues are going to do in terms of reaction?
Well, I can't speak for everybody, but for me, myself, I would not support the governor for reelection. You know, I just like we did last year with other somewhat related bills, although this one is a lot worse, I have no problem calling out the leadership of our party or the titular head of our party for doing something that is so offensive. But in conversations I've had with others, I know that others would feel the same way. But again, I can't speak for everybody.
All right. He is State Representative Tom Morrison, Republican from Palatine. Tom, thanks as always for joining us. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
And, Patty, here's something interesting. Because of the legislation recently, if Governor Rauner signs HB 40, then he does now have the option to change his name to Margaret Sanger because of the transgender birth certificate bill he signed.
Yeah, I think Diana Rauner already took that name, so that won't be available to him. Look, Dan, this is what I think is happening. I think he is coming up with his alternate play. He knows his numbers are bad. He knows that his chances of reelection sitting here right now are daunting, right? So what do you do in that circumstance? You carve out your secondary legacy. Hey, I couldn't reform Springfield. Mike Madigan was brutal. The right of my party are a bunch of crazy right-wingers. But look what I got done on sanctuary state. Look what I got done on transgender rights. Look what I got done on abortion rights. And he can go back to his, you know, suburban enclaves and his 12 houses and his crazy wife and say, look what we've accomplished. I think that's the play.
Well, I think his wife is crazy. I think she's just a leftist ideologue.
And I'm not saying crazy mentally. I mean, crazy positions, insane positions.
Well, so here's the thing. Governor Rauner, when he was a candidate, said no social agenda. Diana Rauner recently said she considers both herself and her husband, Bruce, to be social justice warriors, who turned out to be telling the truth.